Hello. I'd like to welcome everyone to the food and design panel. I first would like to thank the New School for allowing us to host this. I'd like to thank Parsons, the School of Design Strategies, and also the New School for Public Engagement. This is an exciting opportunity for us. The two schools, School of Design Strategy and Food Studies, as a program within the New School for Public Engagement, to collaborate and see where food and design goes as an area or a pathway or a minor, hopefully, moving down the road. Fabio, I'm Adam Brent, by the way. I'm the Director of Integrated Design at Parsons. It's a program within the School of Design Strategies. Fabio had asked if I can give a brief history of where this growing partnership has come from. And basically, it started with a conversation I had with Pedro at the request of my outgoing dean. And he said, well, we interviewed, and a job talk was given by an amazing designer. He's doing something really fascinating. I think the integrated design program would be very interested in his research and his practice. He designs with food. I said, well, he designs with food? What do you mean? He said, Adam, that's just it. He designs with food. He showed us work and presented these ideas and his practices and research with his students, and the prototypical work that came out of that class actually involved working with food. There may be a course that we can develop for him in the School of Design Strategies. Our school transitioned. We had a new dean come in, but the conversation still happened. And I was very grateful for that conversation, because in talking with Pedro and trying to find out where his research and his practice can end up in our school, he put me in touch with Fabio. He said, have you worked with Fabio? He works at the new school. I said, Fabio, no. I'm not familiar with Fabio. Contributor to the Huffington Post, an author, esteemed colleague of yours. And I said, well, I'm going to be put in touch with him, and how wonderful. And we met together, and we determined together that Parsons and NSPE really need to, the New School of Public Engagement, really need to see where we can carve out some curricular space for food and design, designing around the constructed environment in food, food in the culinary world, food as a design process. That really was the start of this, and in turn, we met with Stephani, and Fabio has brought along further esteemed colleagues of ours, and we're going to have this panel today and kind of unpack what food and design can be, looking at their practice and hearing about their expertise, as moderated by Fabio Parasecoli, my colleague, and my new friend. So I thank you guys for coming. This is the beginning, again, of hopefully an exciting suite of courses that will hopefully be a minor as we introduce minors in 14-15 at the new school, and perhaps greater things to come. I have been asked to introduce, or at least speak to a few things. The New School for Public Engagement has a new free online course, Innovators of American Cuisine, A History of the Culinary Arts in the U.S. That is a MOOC, meaning it's a free online course for anyone to enroll in, and enrollment has started on the 24th, which is very exciting. Apparently, there's a lot of students that have enrolled, up to 104 at this moment, so it's happening very quickly. Also, some food studies events, Dining and Design, Expo Milano, USA Pavilion, American Food 2.0. That will be on April 22nd, 2014 at 6 p.m. in the Orozco Room. That's here in this side of the world at the new school at A27. And also, Al Dente, A History of Food in Italy, a book launch, Fabio's book launch, correct? Yes. That will be taking place on April 28th. Congratulations to him. One of his many books and projects he's working on. That will be 6 to 8 p.m., April 28th, in the Orozco Room as well. I hope you guys can attend those events. Thank you for coming. Thank you, everyone, for coming. This should be really exciting.
Good evening. I also want to thank everybody for coming. I thank you to Parsons, the School of Design Strategies, for this collaboration. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to introduce each of the speakers one by one, and they'll introduce their own work. So after that, we'll start a conversation that then will open to everybody. So let's start on my right, Brian Sullivan. He comes from a very diversified background on both the design profession. He worked as a designer for 12 years for over 15 companies. And the culinary field, he's been working for 5 years in that field. His work at Corton, Ai Fiori, Osteria Morini. In 2012, he was selected as to be part of Chef Michael White's team to serve lunch at the White House. And in 2013, he was honored to be in the group of nominees for Star Chef's Rising Star Awards. Brian applies his practice design process to food and beverage in the exploration for new techniques, distinct presentation style, and unique ingredients preparations. Through this uncommon approach, he sees food and beverage as another medium and hopes to bridge the gap between and push the boundaries of food and design. So if you want to, each of them will also have a visual presentation, so please.
Good afternoon, everybody, or evening. Thank you, Fabio and Adam, New Schools and Parsons, for having me as part of the panel. Sorry, I'm going to take my water. Mother Nature is playing with my senses. Yes, as Fabio said, I've got a pretty diverse background in both food and design. I started basically in 2007. I wanted to bring my two passions of food and design together, and then really got involved in the restaurant business around 2008. And since that time, it's really taken away the design aspect of what I've wanted to do with food. But now I'm out of the restaurant industry with my own catering company, and I have a lot more free time. So following this, I'll have a video that I wanted to embed incorporating design technique, but with a food as a substrate. So it'll be kind of patchworked here. I chose this picture here because as we're talking about food and design, they seem like two very opposing fields. But this is actually a microscopic view of mayonnaise. And again, water and oil are not supposed to mix also, but they certainly do, and they're certainly delicious. So food and design, two of my favorite topics, and of course my profession. I've got a lot of different works in both fields. So I decided, you know, we're in a design topic, let's do a quadrant. And I'll start dropping in pieces of work that I've done. Researching for this talk really helped me look back at some of my own work and what I considered food design before. So I'm starting to realize that some things I did were just really more of aesthetic, and other things were a little bit more on the innovative side. So I really appreciated the self-reflection. One of the things that I've done is a lot of food packaging, and it was something that later, before I got into restaurants, I didn't really enjoy doing such, as I read about the amount of waste that it creates. So went from food packaging to directly into food over here. Just a delicious sundae as well. And other dishes I've incorporated more modern techniques where flavor and texture kind of play into it. This was just, again, I incorporate as much design as I possibly can whenever we've created dishes, particularly for photo shoots, is when you get to have the most amount of fun in doing so, because there's no budget anyway, so you can go for broke. And it just really gives you a fun time to explore. I was asked to do a gingerbread house for Christmas in 2012, I guess it was, for Michael White. And since he's from Wisconsin, I thought, well, let's do a little research on Frank Lloyd Wright, since they're basically from the same neck of the woods. So, you know, I got out the computer modeling program and made a rendering so I can get my cooks to understand the design process and how you can apply it to food. And then that was the finished product there. So we had sort of like the landscape, and of course everything decorated as you might find in a Tim Burton movie, I suppose. Some of the people that I've had some honor to work with are Chef Will Goldfarb, who's an international pastry man of mystery and quite the intellectual character. He has a very profound appreciation for design. I suppose a lot of it has to do with his experience at El Bulli, but he has sort of a very comical approach to a lot of things, and this was, he wanted to take Domino Sugar but make it into one of his own concepts. And this happened to be at the old Room for Dessert space. So there was a big play on his nostalgia for there. And his protege, if you will, became my mentor, Robert Truitt. And we did a lot of work together also, conceptualizing things like how does color affect food and your perception of the food, and then your experience of it almost as if it was designed for user experience. This was for another photo shoot. Again, we got to have a lot of fun with it. We wanted to create a cornet stand for ice cream. And we just went through the design process of, okay, well, what would you do if you were designing a product? The rule of odds. How does design theory actually help in the plating at a restaurant? How do you make your dish more interesting to the diner, to the person who's going to consume the food? And granted, it's only sitting on the plate for maybe 5 minutes before it's gone. But the artistic aspect of it for the chef is also very important, sometimes more important than the diner's perception of what they're eating. But we thought we would take a look at it and explore it so we could share it with our other culinary friends. He had sort of a crazy idea of he wanted to replicate the mountainside of El Bulli. So we basically took a lot of aerial shots from Google Maps and then, as you would any other design project, built out a mold, and we wound up casting a chocolate mousse cake with all the garnishes that, excuse me, grow native in on the Spanish countryside. So that was a fun project. This was something that took me a long time to figure out how to do it. 3D printing for food has already obviously been very popular. And it had come prior to myself doing this, but it was also very challenging. How do you use food as a substrate to do something like vacuforming? So I designed a concept actually for the food design conference in London several years ago, creating a vacuform bed, finding out what sort of substrate we could use as the food item. So this is Robert Truitt and I demonstrating, let's say, yogurt croquant base. It's basically a crispy edible film that we make flexible and give it shape.
So basically you're kneading the crispy, it's meant to be a flat crispy chip. You're doing sugar. Obviously where the base is. We basically want it to be out in a good state, but very flexible.
Rigid like a plastic, still very delicate, as thin as it is, but something that we've worked on for a while and
it's only going to get better now. techniques only going to get more refined with time.
Literally 2 days before the presentation was when we were able to get that together. So just to wrap up, I'm looking at, okay, so where do we go forward from here for design, food design potential? I look at it as a bunch of different spheres of influence of things that are not just design and not just food. So physiology and psychology, you know, how does our mind act when we need to eat? How does our body act when we actually ingest everything? So you have, it kind of goes a little bit backwards because it's in the core, but the exterior of the body, what happens on the outside of you that, you know, influences your decisions for food. The human history is part of the anthropology aspect. Like, what can we understand about what humans did? I mean, food processing could technically be considered food design, but food processing actually goes back to prehistory when people would dry food for the long, harsh winters. So then we go out to the second level where things start to overlap, or humans are starting to harness nature and understand it, and there's storytelling that's involved. Emotions from, you know, whatever influences us on the outside starts to affect us on the inside. And going to sort of the final stage where you've got mental cognition, where all of your collections of emotions and experiences start to collide and process, and you start to have these memory banks of how you can react in the future. It also starts to harness inspiration, and for both designers and chefs, inspiration is really the soul of everything that you do for the most part. Otherwise, you'd just be throwing food on a plate and creating useless objects. And then I think where they all cross over is really kind of, in my mind, where we find food design and the potential for what it can really do. Thank you very much.
So now let me introduce Stephani Bardin. As you will see, it's a completely different approach, and we're very excited to have four people that look at food design in very, very different ways. It really shows, you know, the potential of this field. Stephani explores the influences of corporate culture and industrial food production on our food system and the environment. She's worked with neuroscientists, biologists, gastroenterologists to ground her research in the scientific world. These investigations take the form of single or multi-channel videos, immersive and interactive installations, as well as tools for measuring and mediating these influences. Her work has been written up on Wired Magazine, Scientific American, Forbes, New York Magazine, The Huffington Post, and many more. She's currently working on an article about the role of science in her work for the Leonardo Journal of Arts, Sciences, and Technology. She's also worked in exhibitions, the Montreal Biennale for Media Art at the Musée d'Art Contemporain de Montréal, the Asia Triennial 2014 in Manchester, and so on and so forth. The list could go on forever. We're really lucky to have her here, and also we're lucky to have her as an instructor here at the new school.
Thanks. Hi, everybody. I'm going to talk about a bunch of projects that I'm working on that kind of span different areas of food design and technology. And I'm going to start by orienting my practice with this quote from Marshall McLuhan. The artist is the person who invents the means to bridge between biological inheritance and the environment created by technological innovation. So my work is a composite of food design and technology. And it's mostly about the influences of corporate culture and industrial food production on our food system and the environment. So the first area that my work kind of takes its location is food in the community. This was a collaborative project I did with Brooke Singer, the Counter Kitchen. And Brooke does a lot of work with environmental toxins, and we reverse engineered a variety of food and household products as a way to rebuild them in a healthy way. So we did Johnson & Johnson's baby lotion, so we made a food-grade version of Johnson & Johnson's baby lotion, because it turns out that Johnson & Johnson's baby lotion has neurotoxins and endocrine disruptors and all sorts of things that go on the skins of babies. So we decided to do a workshop to make an edible. It's actually edible. It's kind of delicious and weird and wonderful. So this was one of the workshops that we did. We did another one on Gatorade. Which you'll see in a few minutes, this Gatorade again. But what we did was we created a language around the ingredients. So the CDP are corn-derived products. The PDPs are the petroleum-derived products. So of the 16 ingredients in Gatorade, water is the only one that's not corn-derived or petroleum-derived. And their natural and artificial flavors is 100% data gap, which means that the corporations are not committed to giving us the information about what's in it. So my work is a lot about taking what is invisible and making it visible to create conversations around that. So one of the projects we did, and I will show you just a very short little snippet, is we did this Man on the Street project where we took four products and wrote the ingredients on flashcards and went around the Chelsea neighborhood and asked people to just read the ingredients. So I'll just do the first project.
Vapor distilled, deionized, and or reverse osmosis water. Crystalline fructose.
Crystalline fructose.
Citric acid.
Vegetable juice.
Cyanocobalamin.
Cyanocobalamin.
Pyridoxine hydrochloride.
Monopotassium phosphate.
Pantothenic acid.
Calcium lactate.
Berry and fruit extracts.
Ascorbic acid.
Ascorbic acid.
Natural flavor.
Niacin.
Magnesium lactate.
What the hell is that?
Vitamin water. Wow.
So that was just one project that we were trying to figure out a way to get some of this information out into the public. This next project is a new one. This is called La Casita Verde. And La Casita Verde is an innovation green space in South Williamsburg. It was a plot of empty land awarded to Brooke Singer and I, again, for an RFP through the Department of Parks for New York City. And we're turning it into basically an open lab about the food soil web, and we're going to bring to the neighborhood. So we're working in concert with about 8 members of the neighborhood are part of our core membership team, and these are people who have lived in the neighborhood forever. And our goal is not to create a community garden where just only a certain amount of people have lots, but the idea is to open up the system to the public and really teach people about what is in their food, how important the soil is. So it's a whole idea around system thinking, like all of this stuff is connected. So this is the layout. It's on Division and Bedford, so you guys should come visit. We are just starting to build and compost next month when it gets warm, and we'll have a party to introduce ourselves to the neighborhood and to you guys as well. And one of the ways that we have been trying to have conversations with the neighborhood and introduce ourselves to the neighborhood is we started working with an artist and designer, Marina Zirkow, who teaches over at ITP. And this was a way to announce our presence and get people understanding our mission around composting. So we're really interested in composting. So the idea was to create a series of posters that now cover the area where this space is as a way to get people to not to have an understanding of what we're doing, but also understand that we're kind of playful around it. So these are just some of the posters that have been kind of put up all over the garden. And it's the idea of transformation, right? And also that the food system has all of these elements, not just like you eat and you throw it away, that there's actually a whole system that most people aren't either aware of or don't understand, and that's what we're trying to do in this space. So we're going to use a lot of technology in this lab, so we're going to figure out ways to make urban gardening more efficient, because it's really not a solution to food scarcity, but it's a way to get people to see how they can contribute to carbon footprint, how they can contribute to their health in better ways. So we'll do a lot of workshops around food justice, around food health, but also creating workshops to use technology to do technological interventions around composting, around seed saving, stuff like that. So I know I'm going to go really fast, but I want to get through all this. So this next project has been an ongoing one. It's called The Fantastic Voyage. So this is me working with a scientist. I work with a gastroenterologist up at Harvard. And back in 2011, we did the first human trial to look at the impact of processed food versus less processed and more whole foods on the body using these wireless gastroenterology devices. So there are capsules that take video of the inside of the GI tract. And we just did one in 2011, and I'll show you the preliminary results. And they were really, really compelling, but because it's science, they needed us to do it like a billion more times. So we just got a grant, thank God, a very big grant, actually, from the company called Given Imaging, who makes this technology. And so right now, we're in the middle of doing this trial. So I'm going to show you some footage. It's like 20 seconds from the first trial, but what's really nice is that I didn't expect this to happen, so it's been a really interesting way for my practice to influence this scientist in the way that his practice has influenced me. And it will be exhibited, as Fabio said, in Montreal. So it's going to have a fine art sort of component, so it can reach a larger audience, and then it'll have a scientific presence. All right, so what we used is on this side is the processed food. On the other side is the less processed food, and you're looking at gummy bears, Gatorade, and Top Ramen, blue Gatorade. And then on the right side are whole or less processed versions of those foods, like a hibiscus Gatorade. We did ramen noodles from scratch, and we made a chicken broth kind of thing. And so if you can see the time lapse up at the top, so that's after about 2 hours. And so the notion was that the processed food took a lot longer to break down. And we don't know what the implications are of that yet, so that's what we're trying to figure out right now. Okay, so this next project is called Microbes, working with a neuroscientist. And this project explores our cohabitation with microbes that live within, on, and around us. And so we have found, the collaborative that I'm in, has found that these microbes that live everywhere actually talk to each other. They influence each other, and the way they talk is very similar to the neural network that the brain sends impulses through the body. So what we want to do is we want to show how your behavior or your interaction with the environment will manifest in these little devices that we are making. So we're going to make these wearable biosensors. So what you're looking at here is agar. So this is just a mold of agar, which is seaweed. We've added a little bit of sugar water to it. And that's bacteria and fungi that have grown as a result of the volatiles that are in the air. So we're creating these little wearables that people can have on their body that will record what the bacteria is in their environment. So we're creating tracking devices. And the idea is that it's a way to show people how they influence their environment, but also what's going on in their environment. Like, what is happening, and is it healthy, or is it not healthy, or what does their pathway in any way influence what they do. So we started off with mung beans, because we want to grow plants and stuff, and so the mung beans have started to grow, which is really great, and the idea is that you can, it's kind of like a Tamaguchi. Do you guys remember those little Japanese? It's kind of like a Tamaguchi. You have to water it, you have to take care of it, but it also becomes a representation of your biotic microsystem and its relationship to the macro ecosystem. And this is kind of how we will eventually display it in a show we're gonna do in September. So this is a project, really quickly. So another way that I use food is a substrate, kind of like what Brian was saying, to talk about other things and ideas. So this was a Creative Times Summit called Art, Place, and Dislocation, the 21st Century City. And they asked myself and chef Mihir Desai to create a lunch that talked about the city of New York. So we chose the five boroughs of Manhattan and chose the problems and wonderful things about each of the cities and created a meal to actually engage that information. So instead of like giving data, we gave food. And so this is Brooklyn, and what we did was we made an edible garden. And so all of that stuff is edible, and it sort of talks about the promise and failure of urban gardens, and that oftentimes the collateral impact on the environment is pushed aside, like in Brooklyn, maybe, in lieu of stuff that's camera ready or can be mass produced, and completely leaving out the impact on the environment. So one of the things we did in this garden is we put something called sedum. So sedum is a cover crop for rooftop gardens. And it's just because it's really hardy and it really can stand up to a variety of different weather patterns. But it turns out that it's also edible, but people don't pay attention to that. So it's like a throwaway. So one of the things we did is we fed people sedum as a way of saying, if you're going to grow this, you should eat it. And it's actually kind of delicious. This is the Bronx. So the Bronx is the largest food distribution center probably in the country. I think $4 billion of food distribution happens out in the Bronx, so between the Fulton Fish Market, between Hunts Point, and between Fresh Direct. The problem is that there is no access to food for the people who actually live there. So the people who live there have, in the Bronx, have some of the highest food-related disease and health problems in the country. So it's this weird kind of smoke and mirrors. So the food is there. There's an abundance of this food, but people don't have access to it. So we made smoke balloons that people would let go to kind of get the idea. We gave people really teeny tiny portions of food that we actually put on mirrors to kind of explain to them, this is what it's like living out there where you have access, but you can't eat it. Manhattan is kind of self-evident, that there is a real disparity between the haves and the have-nots. So we created a sardine can that had a really gorgeous scallop crudo in it to kind of surprise the diners into thinking, what is it really like to actually live in a place where you can't even afford to buy any kind of food, whereas the people who live there pay very little attention to how much the food costs and their impact on that. So it's sort of a play on gentrification. All right, I'm going to switch gears really fast. So the other area where my practice is in my teaching. So I try to implement food design and technology as a way to talk about larger things. So this was a class I taught a couple of years ago here at Parsons. It was a collab. It was food and emerging media. And this was a design student, a graduate design student named Puina. And what she did was she did this really great corollary project called Perfect Imperfections that looked at the way in which our culture views beauty and the way in which we also ascribe those beautiful qualifications to our produce, that we expect beauty in the way that we look, but we also we kind of reject the really ugly produce unless it looks perfect. We've been conditioned to think that it has to look beautiful. So what she did was she created like liposuction for potatoes that weren't perfect. She tried to sew up the carrots that were cracked. All kinds of things to kind of show that we throw away these imperfect fruits and vegetables in the same way that we throw away imperfect human beings. And it's a kind of a gorgeous project. And she actually put some of these in Whole Foods into the produce areas. It's called a shop drop. And the response was kind of amazing. So it's like these, some gestures are really big, some are small. And the last thing that I will talk about is a class I'm teaching right now over at NYU. It's called Culinary Physics, and that's the interactive telecommunications program at NYU. It's graduate students who work in technology, processing, coding, all sorts of stuff. And it was opened up to food studies. So it's a collaboration between graduate food studies students at NYU and these ITP students. And it's kind of been amazing to see them working together and kind of getting a sense of how they can talk about these larger issues like climate change, like all of these things using the science of food. My last thing is that I just found out tonight that I will be teaching a class very much like this here at the New School in the spring. So thank you for that.
Now, let me introduce Rosica Ilieva. She's a postdoctoral research fellow here in urban food systems at the Tishman Environment and Design Center, where she is currently developing an international research project on the role of cities in sustainable food system transitions, together with Nevin Cohen, whom many of you know here. Rosica has recently completed her doctoral studies in spatial planning and urban development at the Polytechnic University of Milan in Italy, where she also earned her master's in architecture. And her Italian is flawless. I mean, when I met her, I was like, really? Are you not Italian? Her dissertation explores the rise of the sustainable food planning movement in the global north, Her research interests include sustainability transitions, the integration of food in urban policy and planning, and the dynamics of social practice. And now she'll explain to us her own approach to food design.
Oh, Fabio, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here with you tonight. It's really amazing to be, it's such a diverse panel. And exciting to see how many different perspectives we all have actually in food. So even though I'm currently actually looking at food through the perspective of more or less more urban policy and planning than design, I'm really thrilled to be with you this evening because how I met first food, actually professionally speaking, was through design. And this was back in 2009 when with two colleagues of mine from the Polytechnic University of Milan, in Italy, we participated at this nationwide competition for vertical gardens design in Italy. And we won the competition. The project caught the attention of several local administrations around Milan and actually turned into a three schools wide educational program. So in this context, we used our vertical gardens projects as a pretext and a substrate, as Stephani said, to talk about bigger issues, to talk about recycling and reusing materials in cities, including also water, recycling and reusing water in urban environment, local food systems, and sustainable ways to relate to food. So this is more or less the time when my thinking about food started quite radically shifting. So I was no more asking myself, how can I design more sustainable spaces for food? But how can I use food to design more sustainable places in general and at many scales, and city in particular, the city one in particular? And I had no idea, Fabio, that I would have found a whole movement behind this question. So both in academia and in urban policy, cities were getting excited about food. So over the past 10 years or so, more than 100 articles have been published on food and planning, on food and design. And in the same, at the same time, more than 30 strategies, urban food system strategies and regional food system strategies have been released in our cities. So this was something that really struck me. And what was even more interesting to me, that these cities weren't looking at food as something marginal, just an additional point to their urban policy agenda, but they are emerging actually from New York to London, from Amsterdam to Toronto, with the ambition to become leaders in food system change, which is quite a unique perspective if you think about food and cities, which have never actually traditionally, at least in our contemporary time, look at food from this perspective. So how do you go about taking food on board as an urban matter? Well, in the urban planning field, several quite intriguing answers have started being given. So from food urbanism to agricultural urbanism to food-sensitive planning and urban design. So these are all attempts to take food really seriously in the way we design cities and use it to build and envision a more holistic perspective, actually, and more holistic approach to how we our cities grow. But what my current concern, and to some extent fear as well, is about that we really risk to miss the boat of food design at the urban scale if we don't figure out how we can learn from innovative food planning practices that have been flourishing literally in our cities in the absence of planning, in the absence of urban policy. So these are more than three decades of sustainable food planning movement working within the system and carving out more sustainable places in our cities. And this is where I am now, and I'm trying to reframe food as an object of study for me, seeing it as a practice. So asking how we can make visible the ways in which our communities, but also forward-thinking policymakers, are creatively integrating new and existing meanings, materials, and skills around food to create more sustainable urban food practices. So taking food as, instead of a, as an object, as a practice, actually leads us to the kind of very interesting place and is an invitation to look, to start fooding the city, literally. And this is the name of the project I'm currently developing with Dr. Nevin Cohen in the Tishman Environment and Design Center at the New School, and trying to think about a different approach to urban food planning and urban policy through the lens of food as a practice. So long story short, back to the micro scale and back to design. So I'm really excited to follow up the conversation. And thank you once again, Fabio.
Thank you. Last but not least, we have Pedro Reisig, who also will start teaching a class, an intro class on food design in the fall for us, and we're very excited about that. Born in Argentina, Pedro grew up in New York, and then he went back to Argentina in 1991. Currently, he lives here for a change of pace and a career shift, and is working full-fledged into food design. His work explores the relationship between form and structures within a paradigm that he calls technomorphology, consolidated in the studio Nudo Design, and the spin-off companies Vaca Valiente, Nova Material, and Food Morphology. A self-taught carpenter, Pedro studied fine arts, graduated from Pratt Institute in architecture, got a graduate degree in technology and production, as well as a PhD in design from the Universidad de Buenos Aires. Okay. Involved in education and research at the Universidad de Buenos Aires since 1992, he has been lecturing and giving courses mainly in Latin America, and now we're very happy that he'll start working with us too. His design work has received international recognition with presence in over 30 countries, ranging from the MoMA storefront exhibition in New York City to the Mori Art Museum in Tokyo. His best-known work is a leather kangaroo, which has been a bestseller at MoMA since 2007. And recently, he's become the founder and coordinator of the Latin American Food Design Network. It's a very interesting initiative. It's also connected with an international food design society that started a few years ago with a seminar in London, and then there was a full-on conference in 2012, and Pedro now is bringing that approach and that reflection to Latin America. And so I'm sure there's going to be amazing developments there. Pedro?
Okay. Thank you, Fabio and Adam and everyone. And very, very interesting to see what the people before me had to say. Before I start, I thought what Brian, right? Mentioned how he got interested in food and design. Made me think it's worth saying. In my case, it's much less glamorous. Mm-hmm. I've always been interested in design, but not in food. I'm certainly not a foodie. And I ended up being a sort of single parent for two daughters and discovered a huge problem, which is food. And this is true not just for nutrition, but the family I had before I separated was the food and eating was a very important part of our family life. So as a single parent, it, you know, things fell apart because it really was very hard to get things going. That made me think some things you take for granted, like food, especially when you're a child or if you have a family structure, things are, you know, taken care of, especially in a traditional family, by a housewife or the house father, whatever it is. But someone is dedicated to, I would like to call it, solving that problem. And that problem is from designing what you eat, sourcing it, bringing it home, storing it, preparing it, administering, and you know, it was a real problem when the expert in that wasn't there. Oh my God, how do you deal with that? And that just brought up a lot of issues, which made me very interested from a need point of view in food and all that's behind it. So it was just not getting food on the plate, but how everything, all these different aspects of this problem came together. And so what I put together when we decided to do this panel is I just wanted to show what I'm doing concretely in terms of food and design. So this is it's not a traditional presentation, but it points right to the question, what is food design for me? So let's see if we, okay. It was very important. We were talking with the rest of the panel before the conference started. How can we come up with a definition of food design? Some of them exist. I think people are timid and cautious to put a definition out there because it's really a very new field and it could mean very different things for different people. I've come up with this definition which has made me much more secure in what I'm trying to do, and it basically says food design is anything that improves our relationship to food. And there's two key words there, improve and relationship. And that, it seemed such a wide but also obvious definition that I was, you know, afraid to use it in different forums, but people, you know, they like it. It makes sense, and it's really opened up the way to think about food in different ways. So this has really been what's helped me get involved here. As a food designer, I think this is the most beautiful image of the food product, the food utensil, and the food receiver. Well, what I've been doing basically the last 20 years regarding food design, I break it down into two areas, research and design, and education. And as of recent, what Fabio just mentioned about the Latin American Food Design Network, I've begun to get interested in bridging things that are really disconnected, and I'll explain to that later, but I'm gonna show very briefly some R&D and some of my work in education. What I call research and design, because it's definitely not research and development, and I wouldn't just call it design because I'm trained in research, and the way I like to work with design is based on research. And I've spent 20 years working around something which I've termed technomorphology, which is basically how four things of any and all produced objects in this world have to contemplate, which is form, structure, material, and technology. Basically, it's taking material through technology, giving it a form, and that form, in 99% of the cases, except two-dimensional design, requires structure. It's a huge word to say something very simple, but very difficult to reach. How, you know, products that have these four things integrated. And then I found that food is a very accessible place to work this out. So taking from there, regarding my design practice, I break it down into three areas. Two of them are more technical, and the third one is much more recent, which has to do with the slow food movement and its relationship to design. Food morphology, this is a self-experiment I did recently, very disgusting, in fact, which is a wonderful plate of food, an Argentine steak there, and a glass of Malbec. And on the right is exactly the same food material. The difference is obvious. I had to eat it to make the experiment valid, or as Stephanie would say, scientific, and it was not fun. So the conclusion is food forms matter. This is a product I've designed about 4 or 5 years ago. There's basically two things going on. That they're both about food morphology. One is, many people know this, cooking a hamburger, the center takes longer to cook than the edges for relationship between volume and surface. One way to make that more homogeneous is to take out the center, which reduces cooking time and lets you cook the burger to whatever point you prefer. And I mean, this is just a very simple example of how form can improve a food product. And the other thing you might notice in there are actual chunks of beef. What that is all about is, what is really a hamburger? My definition is, it's an answer to the problem of how to eat meat without utensils, how to eat meat with your hand. There are very many responses. One is the hamburger, and if what we really want to do is eat meat without our without silverware, we would love a nice piece of meat, but we can't just break it apart with our teeth, at least those of us who don't have perfect teeth. So why not add chunks of the right size and the right percentage into the ground beef mix? So what'll happen is you'll actually bite into beef chunks, which for those of us who like meat, that's what we are there for, and also makes the jaws work, which makes you salivate, which makes it tastier since your taste glands work better with saliva and your digestive juices, as Stephani probably knows, right? So, simple example of food morphology. This is a huge subject. I've looked around a lot. What determines the different bread forms in different cultures? And that has to do with economics, with geography, with technology. You know, a brick oven, flame-powered is very different than electric rectangular oven, and so forth, and et cetera. It's a beauty, really. It's probably the most universal food type we know of, and also historically. Regarding this idea of structural food, can't really get into it in such short time, but I'd like to draw the parallelism between food that has a structural concept and one that does not. And the reason I got interested in structural food really has been as a pedagogical platform for students, mainly architectural students, to be able to integrate these four aspects of technomorphology without intimidating them in a structural laboratory or materials laboratory. They went home to their kitchens and worked with stuff they do every day, but just with a different mindset. So these are all experiments using any material in the kitchen, any technology, and any form to create a structure. They're not necessarily edible projects, but that's been a very popular course at the two universities I teach, and it's paved the way for me to pay attention to this idea of structure in food forms. I'm not quite sure where it's gonna lead, but I know there's something there. I mean, it's inconceivable to deny structure at an architectural scale, at a product design scale. Structure is very important. And I'm sure, I mean, it's got to go beyond the possibility of taking a pizza and folding it in half so it doesn't collapse. The idea of structure in food is very relevant. I'm just beginning to get into it. Okay, slow food. Most of you probably know about the slow food movement. I've been very surprised that there's so much talk about slow food, so much talk now about food design, and there's no connection, there's very little connection between the two. Proof of that is I just registered the domain slowfooddesign.com a week ago. I understand why. I've been a recent member of the slow food movement, but I just think there's a huge opportunity to help strengthen slow food through design, and it has to be a very tuned-in design to the slow food movement values. This is the product Fabio mentioned that's been in the MoMA store, which has really kind of been my business card. And it was actually designed as a tabletop complement, but the MoMA ended up selling it much better as a desktop organizer. But this guy really was born to hold napkins and tea bags and or salt and sugar, just to have an animated object that you can relate to and appropriate. I don't know if any of you know a very, very popular drink in South America, mainly Argentina, Uruguay, in the south of Brazil and Paraguay, the mate. This is the straw to drink that, it's a tea basically, it's called the bombilla. And I designed the bombilla, which again, since most of you are not familiar, I won't bore you with the details, but it was patented, and very few bombillas can get patented because it's not a design patent, a utility patent, so it really has to be better. It has to offer an improvement to the current state of the art, and that happened with that. Education. There's three things I'm doing in education. One is working as a food designer, so I give courses and workshops on designing the food, the edible product, or the rest of the stuff. I'm much more interested in working with food design as an educational space to get people to think differently. That's my whole point. I mean, many people can teach product design for silverware or food products. I'm one more. But what I'm very, very motivated to do is express in this kind of chicken or the egg dilemma, are we what we eat, or do we eat what we are? And I think the traditional version that you are what you eat is a very behavioralist approach, putting the blame out there. So if you don't eat the hamburger, you're not a hamburger. But we really, our relationship to food is determined by what we know, how we think, our values. And it's very interesting, this opportunity to talk about food design, especially in the classroom, to get people thinking that, you know, what are they thinking? That great phrase in the US, you know, what was I thinking? We ask that in the present tense, what am I thinking regarding food? All the food decisions we make, you know, where do they come from? And that's really been the motor behind my my work in food design as far as teaching goes. The correlation is natural in the design world with form follows function, or function follows form. In a nutshell, I work with food design at different universities. I'm very excited about two things going on. One is this seminar I'm putting together for the second half of this year in Columbia, which is really a seminar looking at food design didactics specific to Latin America. That's something that maybe we'll discuss later in the, you know, we're talking about what is food design and food design education. It is different in Europe than in Latin America, I am sure about that. And that's what's going on with that seminar. And the other thing, I'm also working on I don't know the translation in English to a cátedra.
A chair,
right. It's like a chair of food design for Latin America. It's kind of a course module that could travel around different countries and kind of spread the word. Don't think I made a good job describing that, but if there's time, I'll explain it better. And finally, bridging gaps, the Latin American Food Design Network. That was an initiative I took. It took about a year to pull these people together. Not easy business, bringing 15 Latin Americans around the table, especially if there's food, and getting business taken care of. But at least we did enough to sign the founding document. We have representatives from 8 countries in Latin America, and we're celebrating the second Latin American conference on food design in October in Colombia also. And basically what's allowed us to offer this platform is to have this working definition that I mentioned earlier about anything that improves our relationship with food and being sensitive to the Latin American context and practices. So it cannot also be imposed because it doesn't really exist. I mean, food design, someone mentioned the conference, I think Brian did, in London in 2012. That was kind of a milestone in consolidating, at least academically, this idea that's been in the air probably 10 years, not much longer. It's going to become a buzzword, but really just 2 years ago, a bunch of people from different countries sat down and looked each other in the face and said, you know, what's going on? So all that said and done, bon appetit. Thank you.
Thank you. So I've prepared a couple of questions for our speakers, and then we'll open to the public. And then, as you might have seen, there's food, so maybe the conversations can continue also after. And I want to start from an article that came out on the New York Times actually yesterday called Matters of Taste, and it's an article on food design and what it is. And there was a sentence that sort of addresses what we're discussing. Today, designers are playing with food in growing numbers. Equipped with new technologies, motivated to solve problems of scarcity, obesity, and waste, and encouraged by rocketing culinary enthusiasms, they are recalibrating our ideas and taste, our ideas of taste, while preparing science fiction scenarios for our kitchens. So I would like to start the conversation asking, what is food design? And this is the huge question. It is a field, it is a discipline, a movement, an attitude, and who does food design? It is designers, is it chefs? It is the food industry. So I'd like to open this question to our speakers, and we'll take it from there. Who wants to start?
No, I just, it's working. I found really close to what my idea of food design is to what just Pedro said in his presentation. If I need to think about food design and all the perspectives that have actually came out this evening, I'm really tempted to steal a metaphor from the Bauhaus architecture movement in the 1930s, from the spoon to the city. So my definition of food design in a more general, the most general way possible would be any practice that is committed to change the way we relate to food from the spoon to the city. So in that sense, from really designing the object, rethinking what this food object communicates us mm-hmm. to the way the city works as a food system. So I think that if I currently have to give you mm-hmm. Some kind of answer, and there is no straight answer, I think it's not perhaps yet a field, it's field in the making, it's a movement for sure, because we are seeing many associations, conferences coming up. But I think that it, at the present moment should be as open as possible to allow for.
Yeah. I'm gonna take a stab. So I'm gonna kind of riff off that and say, so one of the things that came through very evidently to me hearing everybody talk was that everybody seemed to be doing several things. One was taking things that were not visible and making them visible. And the second thing was a way of looking at things holistically and sort of taking into consideration all of these different parts. So I see it more as a system thinking, that you can't think about food and not think about immigration, and you can't think about food and not think about water, and you can't think about food and not think about climate change. And so I feel like if you're gonna think about food design, it has to be inclusive, and it has to be what Fabio was saying, it chefs mm-hmm. and scientists and designers, and that it has to be a composite of all of these people in order to address the constituent parts of the food system, because it's not just about sustenance anymore. Mm-hmm.
Brian, in the restaurants world, how is this perceived?
Well, in terms of food design, I mean, it's not really a subject at hand in kitchens. I think the creative process is very similar. Mm-hmm. I think through further education, just in terms of the technical creative process from a designer's eyes to a chef's, mm-hmm. is certainly something that's very very easy to apply. But I think, again, going through and looking at all my works, like things that I would have considered, oh yeah, that's food design. I look at it and I'm like, well, it is technically it's food design, but maybe at a superficial layer. Like if you looked, again, I don't know why I like the metaphor of onions. So I continue to use these bubbles and onions. But, you know, the outside layer is just the beginning, and then you get to the core. And I think the core is really what we're striving to find. And I don't think it's going to be a quick result, but I think it's going to be an interesting process. I tend to look at things now as what's the bigger picture. You know, like chefs, I think, are very good at becoming trendsetters, getting, you know, sustainable products that they use in their restaurants that then become buzzwords in magazines and newspapers. And then everybody wants to do the same. Mm-hmm. And that's fantastic because they're doing it from a sense of, no, I really care about what I'm putting forth to you. This is my work. I don't want a pig that's boxed up in a crate. I want a pig that's running free and you know, happy and skippy until the day of slaughter. I mean, just to use one example. And you know, I do that in my own home. You know, I try to get the best products that are grown by a small farm, not necessarily from a grocery store. And I think as we apply more of the design thinking towards some of our problems that some of you have brought up, you know, like we can have more urban farming and answer a lot of these problems. So, well, there's, you know, I've been to the Bronx to shop around and I know where all those vendors come from, and it's astounding. It's absolutely astounding. Like all the restaurants in the city get most of their food from the Bronx. And then you go there and it's nothing but fast food, and it's sad.
Yeah. By the way, this year we started a course on molecular gastronomy in the lab, and so it was an opportunity for students to actually have a hands-on experience of some of these aspects. You know, it was not food design, but in a way, it helps students thinking about what is food, how do we work with food, how is our connection with food shaped and influenced by what the food is and how it behaves. One question for Pedro, since you were in London and Brian was too.
Well, I was trying to do the competition.
Okay. But what do you see is developing from there? I mean, how are the designers that were there interacting? Again, is it becoming a movement? Is there some cohesion? Is there some common goal? If you can take that.
Can I answer the first question?
Sure.
Because I was thinking it never ceases to amaze me how, you know, this idea of food, and we talk the question about, you know, what is food design? There is nothing so omnipresent in our lives from the day we're born till the day we leave. Even if we have it, you know, easy, and someone serves us our food, or we just take out or delivery all the time, you know, it is constantly a part of our lives. So something that big, the space it takes up in the house, in the street, in the, you know, the industry, the percentage of the economy depending on food. I mean, something so, so huge in so many senses. Mm-hmm. We just now are asking this question, you know, who's the specialist here? And I think we have to be very cautious of this idea of food design, because when I first got involved, I said, oh, great, you know, we're now the new, mm-hmm. we're gonna be the highest paid and all that. It's not that way. I mean, things are not the way they are just because it is such a big field. It's not even a field, you know, it is so huge, all these considerations about food, that it's really beyond the scope of any single discipline or person. So what I think is interesting to use the word food design, I'm actually very reluctant more and more to talk about food designers. I mean, I work in design and I work with food, so I guess in a way that could make me a food designer, but I don't think that's an interesting category. I think it's much more interesting to think that we're all food designers, potentially, which means we all have the capability to make decisions, very many decisions every day, from what we eat, how we eat, where we eat it, how we structure our life in relationship to food. And so by making those decisions, I mean, there's design, those are design decisions, where I sit, you know, how I cook, what utensils I use, how I cut, how I chew, all those things are design decisions. So it's a very interesting opportunity to all of us empower ourselves and each other, thinking we're all food designers. And that's what I work with students, and they love it. Mm-hmm. They get it, you know. They are. There's no academy that gives you this, you know, you're now a food designer, congratulations. And the question always coming from the culinary and gastronomy, you know, chefs kind of say, whoa, you know, what do you, you know, who are you guys? So people ask, so do our chefs food designers? It's a matter of attitude. Mm-hmm. If a chef considers him or herself a food designer, they're a food designer. So I think that's a very interesting idea. And it's such a big, big deal that it's, even though there probably will be this new field, and you know, we are working on that, it's much more than that. And I hope we don't just reduce it to a major or a minor mm-hmm. or a profession. Even though that's part of it, I think the opportunities to think food in, you know, the big picture, as everyone here has been talking about.
All right, I'd like to open questions. We have microphones. Actually, we are live streaming this event. I'd like to take the opportunity to say hello to everybody who's watching us over the internet. So make sure to have a microphone before you speak, otherwise people at home won't be able to hear you.
I was going to come to you. As designers, the FDA announced a new nutrition facts label for the first time in 20 years. Can you comment on the functionality of the new design? And if you were designers working for the FDA, would you have used that design, or would you have done something more functional?
Who's going to? Anybody wants to?
I read about it, but I haven't seen it. What is it? No, yeah, I'd love to see it.
Sure, just share this. Let's make sure you're speaking microphone.
Is that the label? It's the nutrition facts and serving size.
Yeah, I guess it's, oh. I don't know if we can. So it's a little complicated, and it's not out yet. So that's, well, it just came out. So it's it takes some time to digest and answer. I don't know if any of you has already had the opportunity to look at it.
I just read about it, and it was, from what I understand, and this is not developed because I only read a little bit about it, but it was about making sure that the data was around serving size, that there was a real question about how the serving sizes were represented on the label. And mm-hmm. so it was an easier way for people, the calorie numerical values bigger. So I think it was a way of sort of controlling people's eating. I'm gonna sort of jump to an area that I'm really interested in, which is the food labeling anyway, because I think if they were gonna rework the labeling, that the labeling should have been developed to actually tell us what's in our food. And that's sort of my comment, is that we really don't know what's in our food, that there's something called the Confidential Business Information Act that protects companies from intellectual property information, and it prevents them from not having to say what's in their ingredients. So that Gatorade image I showed you, that most of the things there, so it says citric acid, they don't have to tell you if the citric acid comes from corn or does it come from actual citrus fruit, so you won't know that. And the way that I found that out is because there's a corn, there's like a website for parents who have children with corn allergies, and they did all the research to determine what foods had corn that were not present on the labels. And I felt like that's the kind of labeling we should have, as opposed to this kind of labeling. I mean, it took 20 years, which is kind of insane. That's the only thing that they changed was the caloric representation. So, mm-hmm. yeah, they should get on that.
And if I could jump in and expand just for a little bit, talking about the portion size, I won't mention who, but I worked for a company while I was still doing design that you may or may not have covered on your presentation. There was something that most of the men in the office were the ones drinking said product, and the women would drink the water product. And a lot of the guys, that we would realize that after a couple of weeks of first starting, that our belts were getting tighter. And it took us a minute to look at it and say, oh my God, this is actually more than one serving size. But the design language says, drink me all the way. And it's not anything new. Schweppes actually did that. They had, in the 1700s, they had a torpedo-shaped bottle. Part of it was transportation from England over to the colonies to keep the corks from drying out and obviously spilling the liquid. The second part of it was marketing. They just wanted you to drink the whole thing, and then, you know, you wouldn't carry around something that you couldn't set down. So in terms of the label, I think it's important to have the portion size, but again, we could incorporate design thinking, make them smaller. That just, all of a sudden, that just solves the problem right then and there. And then in regards to some of the chemicals and additives, I mean, some of these are broken down and actually used in molecular gastronomy, and I've used them, and then to see them on an actual label is actually kind of freakish. but perhaps we go back through this exploration of food design, mm-hmm. and we start going back to the old ways and crafting our own Gatorade and everything else, and then we don't necessarily have to worry about it.
Mm-hmm. Hi. So this has more to do with the process, because judging from the panel, you guys have all taken equally fascinating yet very different routes to define what food design means to all of you. And as someone who has a background a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit psych, a little bit art, a lot of food, what would, I guess, specifically for Brian and Stephani, what would you say to someone who wants to kind of embark on a path that combines those things? And instead of having to, because it seems like you have to kind of do the food thing, do the science thing, then do them together. And there doesn't seem to be a way to do it together without reducing it, as Pablo said, to a major or to a minor. Do you have any advice for that?
Ladies first.
Nice.
I'll jump in.
Yeah, come please.
Okay.
Please.
So in 2007 was sort of when I began exploring food, not just as eating and sustaining myself, but more in terms of my dining experiences were showing me that food could be used as materials just the way that we use woods and plastics in design products. So it struck my fascination. I started teaching myself these things. Not quite the same as actually getting the educational experience. So I didn't go to culinary school, but I was working for free for the man who became my mentor. And eventually just jumped in, clothes on, both feet, you name it, in the deep end. And you know, it's a challenge. Working in the restaurant industry to get that food knowledge is definitely it has its hurdles. But it's something that, you know, I would never change. It gives me a different lens to look at, you know, what we're trying to discuss, food design. I can't speak for the science end of it, aside from the fact that I like nerdy stuff. But you can. You can handle that one.
I'm a nerd too, big nerd. I think I'm going to speak about my process because it's my experience. So I don't know if this would be helpful for you, but I'm also going to frame it in the way that I talk to my students. Hi. I think it's about what you want to say and what you want to do. So I frame it like a creative problem statement. So what is it that you want to say or question or illuminate? And then the process actually reveals itself. So instead of sort of saying, I have to study science or I have to study this, that you kind of maybe step back and think about what is it that you want to look at? What do you want to unpack? And then once you land on that, then the rest of it kind of falls together. And if you're open and willing to do that in terms of not kind of boxing yourself into a certain major and saying, oh, well, maybe if I did take this biology class, it would actually help me understand the science of food, and it would I can incorporate that knowledge into the framing of that. So it's sort of like, I mean, and this is sort of the way I think and the way that I teach, is that it's systems thinking, but it's also taking in a multidisciplinary track, but it's really grounded in what you want to say and do. And I think if you start there, it's a lot easier than saying, what do I study? So, yeah.
Next question.
Hi. First off, thanks There's an anecdote from Mariah Vogelzong. She's a Dutch designer, and she makes a distinction of food design. There's no ability to design food because food is already perfect in nature. So she calls herself an eating designer. So I think it's interesting. A lot of the conversation around food and designing it, there's a systemic approach of understanding where we're getting this, how it's being produced, and then what are the health implications beyond that. What I think is really fascinating is that food is still very much a cultural object. And so there's this poetic end to it where you're framing the meal or framing the context which people are enjoying it. And I think there's a lot of subtleties or maybe invisible rituals that are taking place in that area. For example, 10,000 years ago, a toothless population was saved because of the invention of the clay pot. And these other anecdotes where, you know, house appliances start coming in and completely eradicate servants and a whole staff to make a meal. So I'm curious, in regards to food design and sort of what's happening in contemporary culture, where do you kind of find those new invisible rituals that are happening from the way that we are framing food or the way that we are enjoying food as a community?
I think a lot has to do with social media. I mean, who hasn't seen an Instagram or a Twitter or anything on Facebook where somebody's posting their meal? And at first, when this phenomenon was going on, pretty much most of the people who were working in the culinary world thought it was really obnoxious. But you take a step back and you think about what's actually going on, I think it's genius. I think, let's say, for example, the El Bulli Foundation. One of the things that they want to do is just take a look at as a culture as a whole, not, you know, who's from Asia, who's from Europe, et cetera. But they want to know, as a global community, how are we changing, and particularly about food? So I think, you know, data is the next phase. It's looking at people's health habits. It's looking at what's going on in terms of providing food, whether it's produce, animals, how do we distribute it? What's the best restaurant this year? You know, like things like that. And I think that if we have a central database and we can all access it, and I think it'll help certainly from culinary standpoint. Chefs love to know what's the trendiest new ingredient or who's taking my rankings, you know, things like that. I mean, I think we'll learn a lot from it, and I think we can grow closer, hopefully, as a humankind. But my take. But great points, by the way.
I think that this is also valid and at the urban scale, actually. The role of data technology in particular in this emerging new, I like the way you frame it, rituals, urban rituals around food, is actually quite huge. And if you think about new connections being made between citizens and regional farmers, for instance, so community-supported agriculture programs, all there are to a great extent actually relying on information technology, websites, and a way to make them visible to the citizens that would haven't otherwise access to this information. And even more so, mapping of vacant urban lots, for example. So it's already full of all kinds of different representations of different level of sophistication, where you can visually see how you can, and it becomes an opportunity to reconnect, and an invitation to reconnect actually to the land. So it's really interesting how data, big or small, can change your perspective on how you relate actually to food in the city, from the small plot or even from the plate to the region, right? So I think it's
for sure
really fascinating.
You should probably read, if you haven't, have you read Hungry City by Carolyn Steele? You should read Hungry City by Carolyn Steele, because she maps the city through the food system, and she kind of traces both the problems and the sort of kind of utopic look at how the city plays into the food system. It's a really nice read. Yeah.
Other questions?
Hi. As coming at this question as a little bit as a scientist, a little bit as a university professor, a little bit as a medical person, et cetera, I'm interested in the concept of what you view as improving food in the sense of your taking the risk of making a definition of for design. What improves it for me may not improve it for you. For example, I'm allergic to a number of foods, so what improves it for me may not make any difference to you or may have a reverse effect on you because you may be allergic to something else. And so I doubt that any of us in the number of fields that impinge on design of food that have been discussed here tonight are expert enough to make a prediction mm-hmm. of which things will not have unintended consequences. And so I love it that all you guys are from different fields, but what's really going to be crucially important is to keep learning, that is to be knowledgeable enough about other people's fields so that you can actually share ideas. And that relates to the student question over here, which has to do with that as a medical school professor, I think one of the most important jobs I ever did was to try to convince medical students that they were entering a career that was of lifelong learning. You cannot learn enough. So same with graduate students, by the way. You cannot learn enough during your degree time to serve the rest of your career. It doesn't work. And besides, once you learn more, you actually are able to then ask questions that didn't even exist to be asked when you first went to school. So don't be discouraged if you can't define what you want to do, because you have to learn some things. So just do as much as you can, and it'll eventually become clear.
Okay. Well, totally agree. You know, for different people, improving can be different things. Nevertheless, and this, I take happiness in my training in design. We're supposed to be the problem solvers, but we're actually a step behind that is problem finding. So, I mean, I'm keen and well trained in looking for problems. You know, from all sorts. Well, no. In fact, that's, you know, if the question is not well posed, science struggles with that a lot. You know, people are working down this information highway, but if the wrong question has been asked, the answers are going to be useless. So I think a lot of credit has to be given to posing the right question, identifying the right problems. There are just basic things about improving from accessibility, food safety, food justice, enjoyment, you know, slow food, amen.
There are competing concerns, but the issue...
Microphone, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. The issue I was trying to bring forward, though, is that we are all individuals, and what we are as biological elements is not identical. I'm genetically different from you, and we're all different from each other, unless there's a pair of identical twins here. They have actually 200 or 300 big base pair changes different. And we can't necessarily predict.
Mm-hmm. No, but that doesn't get in the way from working towards striving to improve the majority of things for the majority of people. Okay. And we certainly have more in common than we don't have in common. So
and there's lots of things wrong with the current system.
That's why we're here. Absolutely.
All right. Well, I think it's time to continue the conversation around the food. You're more than welcome. Thank you for coming. Thank you also for those who joined us over the internet. I just wanted to remind you, especially for the people at home, that we are launching this open online course on the innovators of American cuisine. You can find information online on that. And for those who are here, there is a little leaflet. Thank you again, and let's continue this conversation. And thank you to our speakers, fantastic speakers.